Could I Do That? By Simon Hartley.
Read by Glen McCready.
Foreword. Gripping the reeds, I crawled out of the freezing water up to my neck on a pitch-black night in the middle of Dartmoor. I'd fallen into a hidden crevasse during a night navigation exercise with the Ice Warrior team, training for what will be my toughest challenge yet, an 800-mile, 3-month expedition to the centre of the Arctic. The expedition has thwarted many explorers, and our destination remains a place which has never been reached by any human beings. If successful, we will not only enter the history books, but we will be able to provide a greater scientific and environmental understanding of the impact we have on the planet. I have not entered into this challenge frivolously. It is perhaps an understatement to say that it will be immeasurably dangerous. There are countless unknowns, not to mention the cost. We are hoping we will be able to mitigate some of these with acute preparation, planning, and risk analysis. As this book will remind you, if you fail to plan, then plan to fail. It wasn't always like this. By the time I left school, I'd been bullied, failed every exam, and been arrested as part of a shoplifting gang of 9 boys. I was a good kid, but I was easily impressionable, and my self-esteem was non-existent. But I guess there must have been an adventurous streak in me. I'd also completed 2 tall ships races, spent 5 years training as a high-board diver, and completed the Gold Duke of Edinburgh Award as a sea cadet. These were my passions, being active and outside. At 13, I had a few jobs, including paper rounds and door-to-door lottery cards. It seems that being an entrepreneur was also in my nature. I've noticed that life is never straightforward. Challenges are inevitable. It's how we deal with them that is important. After my 17th birthday, I joined the Royal Navy. I signed a 22-year contract, and I loved it. But that wasn't to be. After nearly 10 years, I was medically discharged with a severe respiratory problem. Within a year, I was a civilian. I was devastated. I felt institutionalized and very lost. My answer was to use this experience as an opportunity to change my life. I made the decision to start running and set out to run the London Marathon, which I did in less than 4 hours. I also needed to work, so I became a high-board diving coach. But the money was poor, so I started my first business, a sports shop. To be honest, I didn't have a clue about running a business, and fewer than 18 months later, the business folded and all of my savings were lost. So, whilst working in factories, I began studying business and accountancy and completed a software and IT engineering diploma. I started again for the 3rd time. Within a few years, I was thriving as an IT consultant in the dot-com boom in London, and what a ride that was. My recovery was short-lived, and in February 2002, it all ended. Whilst out on my bike, training for the London Triathlon, I was hit head-on by a car and broke my back. Life became very difficult and extremely painful. I was no longer active, and this had a serious impact on my mental and emotional well-being. I was not just physically broke, but again financially. Often the challenges we are presented with can appear daunting, sometimes seemingly impossible. It's tempting to wonder whether we can do it. We may contemplate whether we have the energy or the strength to overcome what we have been presented with. Experience has proved to me that it is our mind and how we listen to it and act which determines whether we succeed or fail. Without realizing it, I found myself using the approaches that you'll find in this book to overcome my own challenges throughout my life. My recovery took nearly 6 years. I got back on my feet and ran the Chicago Marathon in 2008. Since then, I've run, swum, and cycled over 6,500 miles. I've climbed the highest mountain in Russia in freezing temperatures of minus 30 degrees. I've completed ultra runs, long-distance swims, and an Ironman. But life loves to continue to throw us challenges, and change is inevitable. In 2012, all within 4 months of each other, I lost the business I'd spent a decade building. My long-term toxic relationship ended, and both grandparents died from cancer. Financially, emotionally, and intellectually, I had a breakdown. I've been forced to start again many times. I've picked myself up and turned breakdowns into breakthroughs. I took personal responsibility for my life. I got active, developed my spirituality, examined my passions in life, made plans, and took decisive action. Being physically active has helped to keep me going, and I now focus on helping others through the organization I founded, Take a Challenge. With over 500,000 visitors to the website since its inception, Take a Challenge has helped to inspire others to change their lives through the inspirational stories of everyday people achieving extraordinary things. Now, through the principles contained within this book, you can too. Christopher Brisley, founder and CEO of Take a Challenge, www.takeachallenge.org. Anything is possible. Twitter, @CBrisley. Introduction. Human beings are capable of some truly astonishing feats. On the 30th of April 2008, David Blaine held his breath underwater for a world record-breaking 17 minutes and 4.4 seconds live on The Oprah Show. Wow. In 2007, Lewis Pugh swam a kilometre in the Arctic Ocean at the North Pole. It took him 18 minutes and 50 seconds. Conventional wisdom tells us that hypothermia takes effect when our body temperature drops below 35 degrees Celsius. The water temperature at the North Pole for Lewis's swim was 1.7 degrees below zero. That's impossible, right? If you think that sounds bizarre, John Evans balanced a car, yes, a real live 159-kilogram Mini Cooper, on his head for 33 seconds. No hands. Amazingly, it's a Guinness World Record, not an April Fool. Guinness World Records 2012. It's tempting to think of these things as impossible, or that the people who have achieved these incredible feats are superhuman. How long can you hold your breath? 1 minute? Two? Three? I think I'd be surprised if I managed 60 seconds. Are these people made of different stuff? Do they have magical powers? I guess that depends on your definition of magic. Illusionist David Blaine, 2010, said, "I think magic, whether holding my breath or shuffling a deck of cards, is pretty simple. It's practice, it's training, and it's experimenting while pushing through the pain to be the best I can be. That's what magic is to me." If he can do it, could I? Have you ever said the words, "I wonder if I could do something like that"? Even if you haven't said them out loud, have you said them to yourself? Have they been a part of the conversation in your mind? When I look around me, I see more and more people attempting and achieving incredible things. Did you know that there were 127 new Guinness World Records established in the London 2012 Olympic Games alone, Guinness World Records 2013? Of course, world records are not confined to athletic events. In 2009, Dean Gould broke the world record by flipping 71 beer mats whilst blindfolded. As I sit here typing this, there is a radio station in Doncaster, UK, that is attempting to break the world record for the longest ever show. At 4 p.m. this afternoon, they will have been broadcasting for 80 hours non-stop. Whilst I have never had an urge to flip beer mats or be on the radio for 80 hours, I have definitely thought of taking on a real challenge. As I look on, I can't help asking myself if I could do something exceptional as well. What's stopping me? Do you get that nagging feeling that you're not completely fulfilling your potential? Do you suspect that you have more to give? Would you also like to close that gap between what you've achieved so far and your true potential? As a sports psychology consultant, I have always been interested in elite performance. I have been intrigued to know what differentiates exceptional performers from the rest. For several years, I have been studying world-class performers to understand what sets them apart and what common characteristics bind them all. I've been rubbing shoulders with some incredible people who have achieved some pretty extraordinary feats, such as climbing all of the world's 8,000-meter mountains, completing unsupported polar expeditions, running back-to-back ultra-marathons, and winning mammoth adventure races. I had the great pleasure of getting to know them as I wrote How to Shine, the book in which I share the 8 common characteristics that I found. In fact, writing How to Shine was a mission for me. For many years, I've been fascinated by world-class performance. I've been on a quest to find out how world-class performers think, what they've experienced, how they've approached their challenges, and what makes them tick. However, it seems that somehow I've become infected by them as well. Time after time, I have heard world-class performers describe themselves as ordinary people. They all seem to have a very modest start point. They don't seem to have been imparted with any innate talent from birth. Their achievements don't appear to be the result of luck or simply because they were in the right place at the right time either. If they can do it, surely we can too. The inspiration. As I wrote How to Shine, I found myself typing the words, "Where is the limit? Where are the boundaries anyway? And do you know where your limit is?" As I wrote the words and read them back to myself, I felt an uneasy realization starting to dawn. I suspect that I am very similar to many people. I have no idea where my limits are. I don't know where the boundaries of my potential lie. It struck me that most of us have no concept of where our limits are. We know where discomfort starts, sure, but do we know where our ceiling is? Do we have any idea of what we are capable of? Although I've pushed myself, I also know that I've spent my life working well within my potential. If I'm honest, I have no idea where my limit is. It is unexplored territory, and it's time I started to understand it. The same is true of most people. Even those of us who are on a quest for perpetual self-improvement are unsure where their limitations are. Even if we feel that some things are beyond us, we often do so instinctively rather than through evidence. Do you know where your true limits are? And so, I have set myself a challenge. Powered by the question, could I do that? I am going to embark upon a rather ridiculous endurance challenge. I'll explain exactly how ridiculous it is shortly. However, this book is not really about my challenge. In fact, the challenge itself is largely irrelevant. It is about how to take on challenges. In particular, it is about how to tackle those challenges that seem huge, daunting, impossible. I'd rather regret the things I've done than the things I haven't done. Lucille Ball, American comedian and actress. Your challenges. When you uttered those words, "I wonder if I could do that," even if they were just to yourself, what challenge were you contemplating? Did you also say, almost in the same breath, "I'd love to do it, but there is no way I could," or, "Well, I wouldn't know where to start"? Have you seen performers on stage or on TV, or watched people running marathons and thought, "I'd love to be able to do that"? Have you watched MasterChef, Britain's Got Talent, or Great British Bake Off, and thought, I'd love to do something like that. Have you ever dreamed of turning your business idea into reality, or releasing your creative flair by writing the book that's been incubating in your mind, or making a short film? Do you often hear the words, I really ought to, or one day I'll, echoing through your mind? If we are honest with ourselves, I'll bet we all have challenges that we would love to take on. But for some reason, there is a gap between us and what we'd love to achieve. The question is, how can we bridge that gap? How do we overcome the stuff that currently stands between us and our potential? In this book, I'd like to explore how our minds work when we engage in challenges. What actually goes on in those little grey cells? What does it think like and feel like? I'm going to learn about how to take on a significant challenge from the inside, and I'd like to share this first-hand experience with you as I go. We can learn those universal and transferable lessons which can be applied to any challenge. Do you fancy a journey? Do you fancy a journey into a slightly warm, damp, dark, and squishy place? I bet you don't get invitations like that every day. Are you excited? Have I sold this to you yet? The place I'm referring to is my brain. More specifically, I'd like to invite you into my mind and my thoughts. I'll walk you through the challenges within the challenge that I've experienced in my own endurance event and help illustrate how they translate to any challenge, whether they are physical, mental, entrepreneurial, or habitual. I know that my daft endurance event is going to throw up a host of challenges of its own, and yours will too, regardless of what your own challenge might actually be. Most of these challenges within the challenge will be mental wrestles. There is going to be a conversation going on between your ears, a battle for supremacy between your desires and your fears. There will be a tug of war between your dreams and your doubts, and probably a voice shouting, "Okay, stop now, I've had enough." Part of this mission, then, is to conquer this internal mental territory. Along the way, we'll reflect on how the mental attributes required for such a challenge are developed. In How to Shine, I noticed the toughness that many world-class performers display. Andy McMenemy ran ultramarathons with a torn Achilles tendon. Bruce Duncan injured his leg 2 hours into the epic try and still pushed himself for the next 6 days to complete the challenge. Alan Hinks was convinced that he was going to die at the top of a mountain but mustered the strength to descend. And Michael E. Thornton ran into a gun battle and got shot twice in order to rescue his friend and teammate. Through my studies of world-class performers and my work with elite athletes, I've consistently found that they are all mentally tough. The problem is, I'm not. The truth is, I'm a bit of a wimp. I have an incredibly low pain threshold. I squeal when my wife plucks ingrowing hairs or squeezes a spot on my back. When I'm training, I tend to slow down when I get short of breath or my muscles start to burn. Am I cut out for this? Am I a tough person? Are you? When was the last time you pushed yourself to the limit and managed to push through rather than stepping back when things became painful? There's no shame in doing that. It's normal. It's tempting to think that if I'm not tough right now, I'll never be tough enough. However, like any attribute, toughness is developed. How do we build the mental armor? This journey is going to help us understand the attributes required to succeed and how we develop them. It's not just me. As our journey unfolds, I'd like to draw on the wise words of a few friends of mine that have also taken on significant challenges, arguably much tougher challenges than mine. As well as my own mental wrestles, I'd like to share some of theirs. Understanding how they tackled their challenges can also help us to take on ours. They have been there, done it, and have the merchandise to prove it. Their journeys highlight some of what lies ahead of us. Their experiences can help illustrate those valuable universal lessons and help us to navigate our own challenges. I'd like to introduce you to Andy Reed. Andy was a corporal in the Yorkshire Regiment of the British Army who served in Helmand Province, Afghanistan. In October 2009, Andy was severely injured by an improvised explosive device, IED. Amazingly, he survived the injuries but lost both of his legs, his right arm, and a finger on his left hand. Andy's own challenge started the moment that IED exploded. Steve Williams. Steve is a double Olympic champion. He has rowed alongside Sir Matthew Pinsent and James Cracknell as part of the legendary Great Britain Coxless Four crew. He won two Olympic gold medals in Athens in 2004 and Beijing 2008. Steve is also a four-time world champion and received an OBE in 2009. Aside from his extraordinary success as a rower, in 2011, Steve skied to the geographic North Pole and summited Mount Everest in back-to-back expeditions. Robin Benincasa. Robin is a world champion adventure racer and holder of Guinness World Records for extreme endurance challenges. She's competed in over 40 multi-day, multi-sport adventure races. She has also set world records in 24-hour kayaking. Robin is also a San Diego firefighter and heads up a charity called Project Athena. My brother, John Hartley. John is a regular bloke who made the bold decision to move from the UK and set up both a new home and a brand new business in Germany. When he made this decision, he didn't speak more than a few words of German. Now that's some challenge. All of these people have pearls of wisdom and valuable insights that we can use in our own quest. Finding your challenge. How do you decide upon a challenge? How do you go from knowing that you want to do something to having an idea that is fully formed, clearly defined, with a magnetic quality that makes it irresistibly engaging? I started out knowing I wanted to do something that really challenged me. However, to begin with, I didn't know what. As I let my mind get to grips with the question, a number of ideas began to surface. I spent a while working through them and imagining them. One idea led to another, and before long I had a few possibilities. I'd been inspired by the ultra-endurance athletes, so all of these ideas were based on daft physical endurance events. If I hadn't already started a number of businesses and flexed my entrepreneurial muscles, I may have looked at this as the challenge for me. Equally, if I hadn't published my first book, I could well have seen authorship in the same way. I've already started to take on these challenges and begun to test myself in these domains. However, I know that I've not really pushed my physical boundaries, so this really captured my imagination. I played around with a number of possibilities. It's almost like trying on different clothes to see what fits best or which ones suit the occasion. Should I try to extend somebody else's achievement by going further or doing more? What about adapting challenges that I'd read about or heard about? At one point, I had three or four contenders. All of them were tough challenges. However, as demanding as they were, there was one idea that set off those sparks of excitement and got the adrenaline running. There was one challenge that I kept coming back to and kept imagining. Whenever I thought about it, a smile would cross my face. It excited me and intrigued me. I began daydreaming about what it would be like and working out how I might attempt it. In my experience, that's when you know you've got it. So, what is it? What's my ridiculous challenge? Could I kayak from London to John O'Groats, northeasternmost tip of Scotland, and then cycle from John O'Groats to Land's End, southwesternmost tip of England, and then run from Land's End back to London. It's a journey of more than 2,000 miles. It includes almost 900 miles kayaking in the North Sea, around 900 miles on a bike, and over 300 miles of running. Could I do all this in under 40 days? Now that would be an epic challenge.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.